You're watching one of a series of videos where I had a conversation with three remarkable Christian young adults. We talked about their faith journey, evangelism, church, college. We talked about growing up in church as teenagers. We talked about some of the mistakes our parents made and some of the good they did for us. Here's just a portion of that conversation. I will post a link to the full length conversation in the description below. And I will see you at the end of the video.
Do we have hierarchy when it comes to sin, or everything is the same? I will start with Khaled. I don't know, is it too much of a philosophical or theological question?
I can just like, let's go anecdotally. Like, you know, we all went to like the same teen's church, and I really miss it. I haven't been in a while. But I heard that a lot, and I didn't just hear it from there. I heard it from like a lot of places, not to like call anybody out. I just heard it from everywhere. And then once I got on like social media, you know, there's like a Christian part to social media, and then it's like, you know, the same kind of pastors, and they're good people, but I would just hear it. And I'm like, not like I disagree with it. I think it can be seen as an oversimplification. You know what I'm saying? Like, of course, sin to a certain extent is sin. My point is, how does it affect God? God doesn't like any of it. So if we want to start from there, okay, that's a great place to start. But I just feel like there are certain things that you get exposed to at a younger age quicker. Like, it's more likely for a child, the sin that they're committing is probably lying or being angry. I'm talking about a child. Like, once you first get to the age of accountability, it's just not the same things that an adult might be going through, or even a teenager, specifically teenagers. So I'm not gonna be like, there's a hierarchy. I don't feel like it has to be between two things. Like, is sin sin? Is it all the same? Or is it a hierarchy? I do think that there are sins that open up to other sins. And that's just, I don't know. Like, of the sexual sins that people go through, especially when they reach like a puberty age, I think it opens the doors to other things. Like, I think lying can open the door to stealing, and then stealing can open the door to like, it just, I don't have to say that one is worse than the other, but I feel like different ones can be harder to deal with depending on how far you are into that sin. So I'm not gonna be like, oh, there's a hierarchy, this is worse than this, this is worse than that, this is worse than this. And I'm not just gonna say that it's all the same, because I mean, if it was all the same, then they would all have the same name, but they don't, they don't. And there was a list of 10. That was before, you know, love thy neighbor as yourself. And if you just follow love thy neighbor as yourself, you're not gonna do the other 10 commandments. Like, you're not going to break the other 10 commandments. If you loved your neighbor, why would you steal from him? If you loved your wife, why would you cheat on her? You know, if you loved yourself, why would you, I don't know, like, do all these other things? Why would you hate on yourself? Stuff like that. So I feel like it doesn't have to be either. Now, I don't want to sound like, oh, I'm not trying to choose one or whatever. I would love to know what the scripture says on it, because I've just not heard a lot of scripture on the whole, is sin a sin? But I do know how it affects God. Sin is not something God wants to see us doing, especially if we know, especially if we don't even like repent. You know, you don't know you're sinning. So of course, that's a little bit of ignorance there. It might not be your fault, but at the same time, it's like, you want to be, I don't know, you want to be knowledgeable about what you're doing. And you want to be aware, you know, I think that led back to the beginning of when we were talking about homosexuality. It's not like we don't want people who are part of any kind of community to come to our church, or not our church, actually. Ooh, I messed up. To God's church, because it's not our church, right? But it's about, you own this identity, and it's opened the door up for so many things so many people are going through so many things. Some of it's homosexuality, some of it's not, some of it's perversion, some of it's all of this. And it's like, okay, do you at least know what you're doing is a sin? It's like, okay, if you want to live your life, you can live your life, but for you to come into the church, there has to be an acknowledgement that, not like there has to be, there has to be an acknowledgement that Jesus Christ is my savior. And if he saved you, there's these things that he wants you to do. And of those things, he wants you to love. And I think the compassion part, which is what Della was talking about in the beginning, that's a big part of it. But you still have to know. I know that there are people that are Christians that have like homosexual tendencies that are working on it. See, they knew that this was the lifestyle that they came from. And if you change overnight, you might be lying to yourself, because not everybody is going to change overnight. And it's like, okay, I know this is a sin, according to who my Savior, and how can I work from there? Like, what do I need to change in my lifestyle that could solve so many other problems in your life? I feel like I'm rambling, but I don't want to say it's like a hierarchy and that they're all the same. I just want to be like, okay, I do know that certain sins are not condemned in society as much as others, guaranteed. And I do know that other sins definitely open the door to like other sins.
Yeah, so I think her closing statement is what encapsulated everything she was saying, how like society, right? We see certain sins as different, as, you know, worse than the other. But I think from God's perspective, based off Romans 6:23, right? The wages of sin is death. Like that's clear. Like there's no, the wage was the same for all sins. He didn't say wages of some sins is death, but some are different ones. So basically I see all sins as the same. Whether I lie, whether I steal, etc., it's the same in God's perspective. I think on earth, right? Obviously, people look at adultery, like, especially in the community of men, right? It's not as bad to us as murder, obviously, right? You're not going to jail for adultery, you're going to jail for murder. But in God's perspective, the wages of sin is still death. So either way, the wages of sin is death. So I feel as though sin is sin at the end of the day, but on earth, right? Different sins that we commit have different consequences. Yeah, I think the difference in my answers would be if I'm talking about like from a perspective on earth or if I'm talking like from God's viewpoint.
So from God's viewpoint, you think sin is sin. But yes, on earth, you think because we mete out different punishments for different, there's even some sins that are sins to God and we just turn a blind eye to. And
yeah, definitely. Because in earth, we have the law. At the end of the day, we have to abide by the law, right? But in God's eyes, the scripture is what I abide by. And it says in Romans 6:23, like I said, wages of sin is death. There's no like different, there's no levels to it. Hell is hot throughout. There's no different temperature. So I'm saying like at the end of the day, you know, sin is sin in God's perspective.
Yeah, I feel what Kylie was talking about and how the Lord, how he feels about it. Like what does he feel about this and how he responds to it? And I guess that's what they both said about it being the same to him and how he sees it. But I think the question is how we respond. I don't know. I mean, what I receive in the question is like, what do we believe it to be as people? I think there's no way that we can actually say that. I think we have a desire to do that, but then because of how we view things and how they are to us closely, like, okay, I've dealt with this sin personally, or I see this more, or I understand this more, or I have an understanding for this or that, the way we respond to it is different. And I think that's why we respond to them differently in the body. Because if somebody comes and says they lied or stole, like, so I think it's funny because even when we speak, like when somebody's teaching or preaching about these things, the way you could tell how they feel about it when they're trying to like give scenarios. Well, at least for me, because like, you know, we talk about, you know, yes, stealing and cheating, or when I say stealing and lying and all these things. I remember my mom growing up, she would say this thing, I'm gonna say it in English, because yeah. But if you're gonna steal, hold on. So I gotta say Yoruba.
You're trying to convert the Yoruba to English.
Yeah, but I couldn't. I had to say it out. But I don't know if I should say it out and then say the English. Toba baro, oh my jale, toba jale o makwayo. So if you lie, you steal. If you steal, you can have the audacity. You have the ability to kill somebody, bruh. And I think that goes to what Kylie was saying, as to there are like things that open. But I think everything has the ability to open it, because it's like, it's not about the act of it, but your heart towards it, or what this thing means to you. So if you are just lying, like I said, you could have the ability to steal. And if you can steal, what is growing in your heart? It's not about like, oh, you're grooming yourself in terms of the act, but what you're opening your heart to is to be able to do these things the more. So I believe that to the Lord, that these things are responded to in a, I want to say the same way, because the wages of sin is death, yes. But then I think, I can't remember where it is, like there's a specific thing that talks about in adultery, like the way that's responded to, I cannot remember where it is. But what I remember it to be is like something a little different, or it says something that I want to find it. I'm not going to find it in time, but I'm going to let you know about it after, because I'll look for it. But I think in the Lord's eyes, that the way he feels about all these things are the same, but the way we respond to it or see it to be is not the same thing. Because then when a murderer comes out of jail and tries to come to the body, how do we respond to that? If a pregnant girl comes in that's young, how do we respond to that? But if somebody comes in, like the sins that we can see with our eyes, or that there's a response to that. Because it's like, you can't say that, because the sin that you don't know about, you don't respond to that person the same way you would with somebody who sees it. And and this is not the desire, because, you know, as people in the body, we don't want to have that, but this is the reality of it, I believe. Because it's like, if you're talking to somebody who's a thief and a liar, or a gossiper, or a prideful, you're not responding to them like a regular person. But the way you interact with somebody who you know has literally done the sin that has been, or somebody who has been outed as to be an adulterer, or somebody who has been a fornicator, or a murderer, stuff like that, or an LGBTQ person that you can see, you know, you can see their appearance and have that thought, the way you respond to them is different. And to say that that's not true in the body is literally proving the point as to we are just constantly saying these terms or these sentences because we want to believe it, but our hearts are so far from it. Like, we're not even trying to believe it. We have to convince ourselves that we have, and we just keep it pushing.
Man looks at the outward. It's only God that looks at the inward. Man looks at the outward. Only God looks at the inward. That is, so any sin, any act that has an outward manifestation, that has a grievous outward manifestation, that hurts others, like murder, like that just has a consequence that we can see with our eyes, men would have some kind of judgment on that. That's why, like David said, we send people to prison for murder, but we don't send people to prison for lying or for cheating and things like that, because there's an outward, you know, grievous impact of that kind of sin, and you know, it flies in the face of everything we know to be right. So, but God looks at the inward, and guess what? It is the inward that matters more than the outward, because first and foremost, we are man is spirit. You know, we have a soul and we live in the body. So, the what happens on the outside is a manifestation, actually, of what of the condition of our spirit, of what's going on the inside. And that's what God really cares about. So there are sins of the spirit. For example, idolatry, for example. Idolatry is the sin of exalting something else above God. It could be money, it could be women, it could be material things and things like that. But it is when you, in your heart, nobody can see, when you're committing idolatry, nobody can see that. Nobody knows that. It's just the state of your heart, right? And that is potentially more grievous to God than any other kind of sin, because you've essentially displaced him. You have abused the natural hierarchy of things, the way God set things to be. The way God set things to be is that he is above all. And when you now, in your heart, move God out of that place, and you put something else in its place, then that is grievous to God's heart, and that even has implications in the society. Idolatry has implications in the broader society, but we will not just be able to say that, oh, it's the root of that is idolatry. When someone exalts money above God, then they will do anything to get the money. When someone exalts their sensual or sexual pleasures above God, above, you know, everything, then they would do anything to get those kind of things. And those, of course, would lead to many other things that we may be able to see, we'll be willing to kill for those kind of short fixes. So that's my thought on that. I think in the society, I think David said it right. In the society, because we look at the outward, then we give different consequences for different kinds of sins. We wouldn't even call it sin. We'll call it maybe a transgression or disobedience, something that is against what our moral judgment, that we give it different, we meet out different punishments for those things. But God also says that, you know, talking about sexual sins, for example, he says that, you know, there are certain sins that are against our body. I think there are signals in the Bible, if we look closely, that suggest to us that not only are some sins more grievous to the heart of God, the consequences of certain sins are even worse in society. You know, I think there are signals like that. Like, for example, when it says that, anybody that commits this kind of sin sins against his own body, that is saying something. That is saying every other kind of sin is not against your body, but when you're sinning against your body, which is the temple of the Holy Ghost, then there's something, there's something that is being communicated in there. When the Bible lists, for example, I think it's in Proverbs or it's in Psalms, lists that there are 6 things or 7 things that are an abomination unto God. Well, that list is giving us a window into God's heart about, oh, there are these 7 things that I should pay attention to that really grieve God's heart. That's a window. And if something is not on that list, it doesn't mean it doesn't grieve God's heart. It doesn't mean that then you don't have permission to go do it, even though it's a sin. But it just means that those things, those 7 things, you better not be found doing them. Because it's laid out in white and black that those things grieve God's heart, that those things are an abomination unto God. And I think, we can also talk about, okay, what was the first sin, for example? Was it the sin of pride? You know, there are people who would even argue that every kind of sin stems from pride, right? Stems from exalting yourself above more than you should. So pride and idolatry, if I was to give sin an hierarchy, before I say that, I think the most important thing, more than the fact that whether there's an hierarchy or not to sin, the most important thing is every sin, no matter what the sin is, has been paid for. The same blood that blots out lying blots out murder. I think that's the most important point here. That is, no matter what the sin is, if you like, give it an hierarchy, if you like, don't give it an hierarchy. Every kind of sin has been paid for. And it's when you're not going to, we don't need another blood to pay for someone who committed murder. Yeah. We don't need a different kind of solution for someone who is just a petty liar. It's the same solution, because all sins corrupt us, corrupt our mind, and they separate us from God, you know. And so it's the solution to every kind of sin, whether you give it an hierarchy or not, is the blood of Jesus that was shed on the cross of Calvary. And I think that's really the key. We human beings, we look at the hour, so of course we would have emotional reactions, we have moral reactions to things that we can see, but at the end of the day, God's heart is pricked, and every sin, the result of every sin is that it separates us from God. And anything that separates you from God, you should worry about it. You know, anything that separates you from God, that is a big, big problem, and you should worry about it.
I was gonna say that even when you're talking about like the sins that are just like that are responded to like by with jail time or with a fine or something like that, I think about it, because when you're talking about like the Lord looks at the scripture talking about the Lord looks at the inward and you look at the outward, it's like the person who is jailed and decides to actually like repent of their sin to the Lord, and within the first week they're in a different place than the person who has no consequence to their sin but is continually pushing that and doesn't see that there's a need for repentance in their sin. But it's not, these are not things that we can see. I guess it's just a matter of looking to Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, and not looking at like, oh, you hear, because it's like, why do I have this much time to look at this and believe that I have a say-so in that matter, if that makes sense.
Now, if you would like to make Jesus the Lord of your life, please say this prayer with me. Heavenly Father, I acknowledge that I am a sinner, that Jesus died for me, and that you raised him up from the dead on the third day. Father, please forgive my sins. I accept Jesus as my personal Lord and Savior. Amen. You are now born again. Thank you very much for watching this week's video. I will see you on the next one. Bye-bye.